to this month's A to Z of Tudor places. It's Sarah, the Tudor travel guide here. And this month we are finally back on English soil and travelling to an area of the UK known as the Midlands, or as one 16th century resident of the castle called it, the navel of England. It's the place that witnessed one of the greatest parties of the 16th century, and where one ambitious courtier made a final play for the hand in marriage of his mistress and queen. We are talking, of course, about Kenilworth Castle. Today, the Tudor story of Kenilworth is no doubt intimately bound up with the story of Elizabeth I and Robert Dudley, Earl of Leicester. Debate still rages over whether the two were ever lovers. And while we will probably never know the truth of the extent of their physical relationship, no one would argue that through life and even in death, the two shared an unbreakable bond. And I believe that nowhere is this more evocative of that love than the romantic ruins of Kenilworth Castle. So if you want to time travel and touch Elizabethan Kenilworth at the very zenith of its splendour, then stay tuned, as today we will hear directly from an eyewitness to Elizabeth I's arrival at Kenilworth Castle in the height of summertime, 1575. So my friends, let me set the scene for you. It is in fact the 9th of July 1575. The days are long and the evenings are balmy. Swifts and swallows screech out their call on the wing, swooping and diving across open sky as Her Grace the Queen approaches Kenilworth Castle, riding upon a magnificent palfrey, a vision of glittering majesty as the sun begins to set across the great lake of Kenilworth. The following are the words of Robert Langham, who describes himself as mercer, merchant adventurer, and clerk of the council chamber door. He leaves behind an account of the Queen's approach to the castle.
On Saturday the 9th of July at Long Itchington, a town and lordship of my lord's, within a 7 miles of Kenilworth, His Honour made Her Majesty great cheer at dinner and pleasant pastime in hunting by the way after, that it was 8 o'clock in the evening ere Her Highness came to Kenilworth.
Before we return to our story of the most magnificent spectacle ever witnessed at the castle, let us find out a little bit more about its history. Well, Kenilworth Castle had once been a Midlands stronghold and retreat of medieval kings. Subsequently, it was greatly embellished by John of Gaunt, son of Edward III, in the 14th century. Gaunt built the Great Hall and private apartments, which run along the west side of the inner court, and it turned it from a feudal stronghold into a palace. In fact, it became a favourite residence of Lancastrian kings, and Henry V even built a pleasure palace across the lake from the main castle on its northern side. This was called Pleasance in the Marsh and was described in the 16th century antiquary Leyland's words as a pretty banqueting house of timber. Here I will let Robert Langham step in again and describe the position and appearance of the castle as it was in that halcyon summer of 1575.
The castle has the name of Kenilworth, but if truth grounded upon faithful story, Kenilworth. It stands in Warwickshire, a 74-mile northwest from London, and, as it were, in the navel of England. 4 miles somewhat south from Coventry, a proper city, and a like distance from Warwick, a fair shire town on the north. In air sweet and wholesome, raised on an easy-mounted hill, is set evenly coasted, with the front straight into the east. Has the tenants and town about it that pleasantly shifts from dale to hill, sundry wherewith sweet springs burst forth, and is so plentiful and well sorted on every side into arable, meadow, pasture, wood, water, and good air, as it appears to have need of nothing that may pertain to living or pleasure.
So now, my friends, let us return to the party and pick up the story of Elizabeth I's arrival at Kenilworth. Well, after being greeted by pageants and poems along the length of the bridge which led into the castle and the base court, our friend Robert Langham tells us.
So, passing into the inner court, Her Majesty, that never rideth alone, there set down from her palfrey, was conveyed up to her chamber, when after did follow so great a peal of guns, and such lightning by firework, a long space together.
But the question is, what do we know about Kenilworth Castle's palatial lodgings in which Elizabeth stayed? So they were accessed from the inner court by a broad stair gently rising. Any visitor would then pass into the lobby of the Great Hall, sited at first floor level. According to architectural historian Anthony Emery, he calls the porch, which was the entrance to the main hall, magnificent, and that it hinted at the splendour to come with its slender pillars and foliated capitals. Now, the hall of Kenilworth Castle was one of the grandest in England at the time of its construction. It measured 89 feet by 64 feet internally and was an impressive sight. Even today, it remains so. Its huge windows dominate. And so let us once again slip back in time and accompany Elizabeth as she dismounts her horse and climbs the stairs leading into the Great Hall. Torches and candles have already been lit. The fires in the hearth fill the air with the welcome scent of wood smoke. Without stopping, we pass straight through the hall via a lobby in the Saintlow Tower, which has, quote, generous windows and seats overlooking the protective lakes and fields of Warwickshire, unquote, before we continue on into the wing containing John of Gaunt's original medieval lodgings.
It is rare beauty of the building that His Honour hath advanced, is it not? Every room so spacious, so well belighted, and so high-roofed within, so seemly to sight by due proportion, by daytime, on every side, so glittering by glass, at night by continual brightness of candle, fire and torchlight, transparent through the lightsome windows.
We pass through a triangular antechamber and private lobby, which is filled with guests who bow low to the Queen as she passes by, before we follow her into Gaunt's original private hall. Measuring 58 feet by 23 feet and set at an oblique angle to the main hall, it is lit by two large windows overlooking the lake and separated by a fine fireplace carved in stone. Through two more progressively intimate rooms we must go, a triangular shaped private lobby, well endowed with a screened bay window projecting into the courtyard and with a double garderobe facility opposite, and then on into a still smaller chamber, the most intimate yet, once a place where Lancastrian lords and princes could retire with their families and close confidants. In 1553, Kenilworth Castle had been granted to John Dudley, Duke of Northumberland. Yet following his execution, it was in fact forfeit to the crown, as might be expected. But eventually, Elizabeth returned the property to his son, the Earl of Leicester, and Dudley had, in turn, demolished the innermost chambers built by John of Gaunt and instead replaced them with a magnificent four-storey tower block designed specifically to house the Queen and her most intimate courtiers. And this is where we are headed next. A principal staircase gave access to the Queen's apartments, which occupied both the first, principal, and second top floors of Leicester's Tower. Now, for many a year, this tower was not accessible at all, and you could only gaze up at it from the ground below. However, thankfully, a few years back, English Heritage, who currently care for the castle, installed an internal staircase, and this now gives any visitor access to all levels of the tower, and it allows us once again to access the inner sanctum of Elizabeth's chambers at Kenilworth. So what of these lodgings? Well, on the principal floor there was a large privy chamber which runs north-south on the courtyard side of the building. There was a withdrawing chamber with a large mullion window overlooking base court to the south and decorated by a colourful frieze occupying the upper third of the walls. Beyond that, there was the Queen's bedroom and inner chamber, the latter being used for the Royal Council meetings. Leading from one corner of the Council chamber was a staircase which wound its way up in a small turret to the top floor and onto a beautiful gallery overlooking the lake. And it is here where the Queen entertained only her most intimate courtiers. Even today, it's easy to imagine how it was filled with light on sunny afternoons, possible because of the large windows which face south, west and north on three sides of the chamber. Now, sadly for us, the castle now lies in ruins. Its end came with its slighting following the English Civil War. However, these ruins still have the power to evoke a sense of enduring tenderness, with more than enough remaining to allow us to draw back the veil of time and touch again, however fleetingly, the historic love between a queen and her childhood friend. Now, as is my way, I would like to provide you with a little bit of visitor information should you be choosing to visit Kenilworth Castle. And hopefully, I'll also be giving you a couple of insider tips along the way. So if you are visiting Kenilworth, it's good to note there's plenty of car parking on site alongside the usual cafe within the castle itself. So you do need to purchase a ticket if you want to access those facilities, including the WC. Now, normally during the summer months, there are also plenty of special event days involving reenactors, including Elizabeth herself and her entourage, and they are excellent and I can highly recommend them. Now, the good news is if you like travelling with your four-legged friend, you can take your dog into the castle on a lead, but you might want to consider also enjoying spectacular views of the castle from the meadows which surround it. Now, this used to be part of Kenilworth's Great Lake, but this is now drained and is used for grazing of livestock. But it's a great place to let your dog off the lead and run around if they are travelling with you. Now, as I mentioned, once you are within the castle, there is a cafe on site. But if you do want more choice, maybe a more hearty meal, make sure you check out the pub across the road because it's a splendid place to eat. It has both a large indoor and outdoor dining area and a very extensive menu. It's one of my personal favourites in the area. And also, you might want to consider taking a walk towards the old town. There's a lovely little patisserie there, and you can amble back to the castle through the park, which in fact was once the site of an abbey. And the park, therefore, unsurprisingly, is called Abbey Fields. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this very brief saunter through time to enjoy once more the mighty Kenilworth Castle at its zenith. If you want to read more, you can check out my blog. The link is above and is also included in the description below. So until next month, my friends, when we visit the playground of the Tudor dynasty, Ludlow Castle in Shropshire, I wish you many happy time-travelling adventures.